This is Black Agenda Radio, a weekly hour of African-American political thought and action.
Welcome to the radio magazine that brings you news, commentary, and analysis from a Black left perspective. I'm Glen Ford, along with my co-host, Nellie Bailey. Coming up, a supporter of Muslim Congresswoman Ilhan Omar says Democratic leadership is on a collision course with the party's voter base. A supporter of sex workers in South Africa talks about the priorities of African feminists. And we'll hear from a political activist who is organizing in the bowels of the U.S. prison gulag.
But first, advocates for community control of the police in Chicago took the battle to the electoral arena last month, filled in candidates in each of the city's 50 city council districts. Before the February 26 election, only one city councilman could be counted on to support C-PAC, the proposed Civilian Police Accoutability Commission. But Frank Chapman of the Chicago Alliance Against Racism and Political Repression says community control advocates are now a force to be reckoned with.
Well, so far we've come out of it with 11 people actually elected to the city council, CPAC supporters, and that includes both people who were previously on the board and people who were newly elected. The newly elected people out of the 11 was Daniel Laspada, Michael Rodriguez, and Maria Haddon. Those are the newly elected people. The people that were already on that got reelected as CPAC candidates was Roderick Sawyer, Anthony Beal, Susan Garza, David Moore, Roberto Maldonado, and Carlos Ramirez Rosa. And Carlos Ramirez Rosa, who's a socialist, who's on the city council, has been our most outspoken advocate. Now, on the runoffs, we have a number of people. All of them, for the most part, have never been on the city council before, but a couple of them have been, like Howard Brookins and one or two others. But most of the people that are on the runoffs, like William Calloway, Rafael Yanez, Jeanette Taylor, Nicole Johnson, Byron Cico Lopez, Jessica Gutierrez, Felix Cardona, Rosanna Rodriguez, Sanchez, and Andre Vasquez, Matt Martin, and Mariana Lalonde. Those are new people. Most of them are not professional politicians and come out of the grassroots movement. We're in a very good position. We're going to increase our people on the city council no matter what. But if we win all of the 14 who are in the runoffs, then we will have 25 people on the city council that are CPAC people. That's historic, because that gives us half of the city council. And there are no prophets here in Chicago who foresaw this. This is strictly and solely the result of the work of our movement and the people that we have influenced.
Yes, that wouldn't be just a faction of the city council, but a possible majority and certainly a huge block.
A huge block. And it sends a very definite message to the powers that be in this city. And that is that the fight for community control of the police is the only real democratic struggle that's going on in this town around the issue of police accountability. There are other groups who want to set up review boards and oversight committees and commissions and so forth and so on, but those are bureaucratic solutions. Our solution is a democratic one that involves the people. And we have proven that in these elections, because the people have given us a referendum in these elections.
Well, democratic solutions are what most scare the police and the folks downtown that really run the city.
Absolutely. And at this particular point in time, they are definitely running scared. There's no candidate running, whether it be for the mayor's office or whatever, that is not addressing this issue of police accountability, because this is a very volatile issue here in the city of Chicago, and it's going to make a great difference going forward in terms of our struggle for our democratic rights to be respected.
Now, C-PAC would actually be in charge of hiring the police superintendent and of investigating police misconduct that must send shudders through the cops' ranks.
It most certainly does. Well, the FOP is our archenemy, the Fraternal Order of Police. They do not want this because, you know, people who want a police state, they don't want democratic forces controlling them. So they don't want this. And they are bullies. They're political bullies. And they have the present city council, the sitting city council right now, they have been pretty much bullied. And, of course, they have the business community also bullied. So this is very important. If we can break through here, it will be a major breakthrough.
The two black women who will be vying for the mayor's office, neither one of them have endorsed CPAC. They must be considering their stance.
Yes, they are. They may act like they're not, but in fact, they are. And after April the 2nd, it'll be a different story. Right now, they're going for soft reforms. They're going for recycling the problem by setting up review boards and oversight commissions and that sort of thing. But the people of Chicago are tired of that, and we have demonstrated that in this election. We had over 173,000 people to say that they want some fundamental change in the way that the police operate in this city, and they want that change to be in the hands of the people and not in the hands of City Hall and the mayor.
What do you expect the Board of Aldermen's order of priorities to be after this election?
Well, it's certainly going to be different, and community control of the police is going to be on the agenda. That doesn't mean we're not going to have to fight like hell for it, because we are. Because they haven't ran out of resources to oppose us. So there's going to be a fight. But we're definitely on the front burner.
Now, you've switched your emphasis to the electoral arena, but you've still got all those troops, the ones that you sent out into the wards for the election.
Yes, we can never get them off of standby. They're going to have to continue to be on standby. The political education that we're trying to give our people here in Chicago is that politics don't move without the movement. And even though most of these people are not professional politicians who are being elected to the new city council, and most of them come out of our movement in one form or another, still, once they get elected, we will have to keep the movement going strong because we know what happens. We've seen it happen before in the past. We saw it happen with members of the Black Panther Party back in the 70s and the 80s. Some of them got elected right here in Chicago. And, you know, once they got in the city council and there was no strong movement behind them to push them, they went along with the system. And so we've absorbed that lesson well. We're not going to do that. We're going to keep the movement going, and we're going to continue to build the movement. We have over 55,000 supporters, but we're not satisfied with that. We need 100,000. We need 200,000. So we're going to keep on going.
There's been a lot of media attention to the election of 5 socialists to the Board of Aldermen. Are all of them supporters of CPAC?
All of them are. I'm doing some investigating as to who these socialists are, though. But they got to be supporters of CPAC because this is the most progressive agenda in the city right now.
Which of the 2 black women who will be in the runoff for mayor do you believe is most amenable to CPAC?
Well, sad to say, I don't believe either one. One is an old machine politician, and the other one was in the employ of Rahm Emanuel, the outgoing mayor, for most of her political life here in this city. Lori Lightfoot, she headed the police board. She stonewalled us all the way when it came to fighting police crimes. So we don't have any confidence in either one of them. We're trying to change the city council so that no matter who is the mayor, we can force our position.
And do you think you'll bring the same kind of street and electoral muscle to community control of schools?
Absolutely, we have to. And that process is already in motion. We work very closely with the Chicago Teachers Union. They endorse us and we endorse them. And the same thing is happening in these elections. So that's the only way forward. There has to be a combination of organized protests and political struggle.
That was Frank Chapman of the Chicago Alliance Against Racist and Political Repression.
Ilhan Omar has only represented Minneapolis in the U.S. Congress since January, but Democratic Party leadership has already targeted her with two congressional resolutions, indirectly charging Omar with anti-Semitism because of her criticism of the Israel lobby. Shahid Buttar is a lawyer and human rights activist and a former director of the Bill of Rights Defense Committee. Buttar plans to run against House Speaker Nancy Pelosi in the upcoming Democratic primary in San Francisco. He says Democratic leadership is trying to show leftish members of the party who's boss.
It absolutely does. Seeing the split between, on the one hand, career incumbents who were willing to shoot themselves and the party in the feet by adopting Trump's foreign policy vision, and on the other hand, insightful voices of not entirely freshmen. I'm thinking of Bro Khanna, who also demonstrated some independence here, but mostly freshmen members of Congress, women who took the bold and long overdue step of asserting their First Amendment rights and the independence of the Congress politically from essentially co-optation by foreign powers. And whether you look at this through the lens of the new McCarthyism, whether you look at this through the lens of the strategic co-optation of the Democratic Party, whether you look at this through the lens of a resurgent and empowered grassroots base flexing its interests to force the party leadership not to support Trump's foreign policy, there are a whole range of ways in which this split appears in very sharp relief over the last week.
Part of the backlash against the attack on Congresswoman Omar came from black congresspersons, with Cedric Richmond, the black congressman from New Orleans, on point. He is said to have taken a big hand in writing the resolution and including many instances of bias against black people, as well as anti-Semitism in it.
It's important for the resolution to acknowledge the various ways in which bigotry emerges, and to the extent the resolution is simply read as a repudiation of bigotry, I think we can all support it. We know, however, that it didn't hatch that way. This was absolutely a proposal supported by the Democratic leadership to censure and censure one of its members, particularly a member who made an insightful comment about the influence of a particular PAC across the U.S. Congress. It is interesting to note the contrast between the NRA here and APAC, the American Israeli Political Action Committee and the National Rifle Association. Everybody knows and talks openly about the NRA's untenable and frankly problematic influence across Capitol Hill. Everyone knows, but has historically not talked about the comparable influence of APAC. And where I see it demonstrated most problematically is precisely in the support of Black Democrats in the Congressional Black Caucus who represent Black communities, who are, and two points to make here, first, relentlessly preyed upon by militarized police who themselves represent some of the institutionalized anti-Black racism that the resolution thankfully condemned, even without any teeth. And second, the particular role of Israel here. Israel plays a very prolific role in arming and training domestic police departments. The paramilitarization of police generally took the route of training by Israeli defense forces in counterinsurgency and urban occupation techniques. So for Black members of Congress in particular to carry APAC's water while the military-industrial complex that spans both our own country and our proxy powers preys relentlessly on their own constituents is It is disappointing, to say the very least.
And in fact, despite their protestations, the Congressional Black Caucus also carries the police water. Just last year, the caucus voted 75% of them for a bill that makes police a protected class. That is, police, who are the most protected class already in terms of impunity, were given another layer of protection by that same Congressional Black Caucus.
It is really frustrating to see members of Congress co-opted by essentially interests that are inimical to their own bases. And one of the issues with police that we have to really remember is that the police officers' unions are among the most mobilized and strong vestiges of the labor movement. And I am a pro-labor person, and in my congressional campaign, we're very eager to support labor rights, to witness the way that the labor movement has been co-opted by, whether it's the military-industrial complex supporting weapons contracts as supposedly representing jobs, or police unions representing another part of the military-industrial complex asserting their influence over their respective representatives. We see both in the influence of local police unions and their own ability to effectively dictate, in some cases, the positions of their members of Congress, and the continued race to hurl money at our military and the litany of defense contractors that supply it. In both of those arenas, I see Eisenhower's warning reflected. And there's one point about Eisenhower's warning in 61 that people forget. He describes in passing what he describes, Dwight Eisenhower, as the spiritual influence of the military-industrial complex. And he describes it as shifting every state and every local council house in the country. When you describe CBC members voting to empower police departments despite their violence with impunity, I think a few examples better illustrate that dimension of what Eisenhower warned us about.
And there is finally, at least in some Democratic circles in the House, the beginnings of an anti-militarist faction or caucus.
This is really important, particularly if we trace it back. It is easy to forget that what cost Dr. King his life was his commitment to three intersecting evils, as he described them: racism, capitalism, and militarism. And there's a further reflection here I'd offer, particularly demonstrated in 2008, when then-Senator Barack Obama was seeking the U.S. presidency. What won him first the primary against Hillary Clinton and then the general election, particularly, was his commitment to peace and justice. He was the only candidate in the 2008 field who could plausibly claim to have resisted and opposed the Iraq war from its beginning. That was the signature position that differentiated him from the rest of the field. What we learned in 2008, empirically from the election, was that America does not support militarism, and we want to rebalance our spending priorities, and we want to support our troops by not deploying them every 3 months to some other harebrained corporate resource extraction scheme. What Democrats seem to learn instead was that any first-term African-American senator has a viable shot at the presidency, which is why we're now dealing with a Harris nomination. It's one of the reasons that Cory Booker is running, right? There's a triumph of identity politics over substance that unfortunately obscured Dr. King's legacy. And I see in Ilhan Omar the resurgence of his legacy within the halls of power in a way that is long overdue. We know all too well how the candidate for the presidency, Barack Obama, essentially fell to the president, Barack Obama, who repudiated many of his own campaign commitments. That notwithstanding, to see a voice emerge among a multi-ethnic group of members of Congress who understand not only how America's interests inhere in peace, but are also willing to frontally challenge militarism and promote human rights in the face of our serial interventions to support corporate resource extraction. It's a really inspiring and encouraging sign. It's one reason why, frankly, I'm very eager to join those voices in Congress and to continue building that case to promote peace and justice and international human rights instead of U.S. militarism and empire.
Congresswoman Omar shows no signs of biting her tongue despite those two resolutions of Congress. You have participated directly in actions in support of Congresswoman Omar.
I have. Now, in addition to speaking out about it in the context of our campaign, challenging Nancy Pelosi for her seat in the House in California's 12th congressional district, this week I had an opportunity to join a delegation of national interfaith leaders and progressive leaders from various organizations who delivered letters to Pelosi's office. We also went to Representative Omar's office, as well as Representative Rashida Tlaib, who's also been outspoken in supporting Representative Omar. And we delivered letters from hundreds of progressive national leaders standing in solidarity with the calls for peace and justice. And to think about the Democratic leadership supporting actively Trump's foreign policy while mouthing resistance to it is frankly infuriating. And to have had a chance to participate in this grassroots pushback that around the country in only a few short days stayed the hands of the Democratic leadership and essentially forced them to expand the language of the resolution to be more inclusive, to at least be defensible and not to duck into this unfortunate co-optation by Trump's foreign policy. You know, you see the Democratic leadership supporting Trump in Venezuela. You see them supporting Trump here in the West Bank. And the idea that Representative Omar is unrepentant, I think, is an important one because she won this fight, clearly. The entire Democratic Party came after Ilhan Omar, and the entire country stood with her. And frankly, we won, while the Democratic Party's leadership, I think, has been rightfully chastened. I do hope that this restrains their willingness to march in lockstep with our kleptocrat in chief. I have very little faith that that lesson will be internalized by the party, however, and I suspect that we will have, for better or worse, any number of further chances to repeat this fight until we reclaim the Democratic Party as one committed to peace and justice, one committed to opposing militarism, and one particularly willing to defend the independence of our own legislators and their ability to speak their own voice without needing to fear recrimination, either by their colleagues or by foreign powers.
Can the corporate Democratic leadership tolerate, live with, abide the progressive faction that now exists on issues of war and peace and of austerity? Are they irreconcilable, that is, the corporate leadership and these new voices, ultimately?
I think they are irreconcilable, and I think that's a great question. There's been, to some extent, a detente between the two wings of the party before this week, insofar as Representative Ocasio-Cortez, for instance, having entered Congress in a prolific, trailblazing effort to mainstream and force to the top of the national agenda issues like the Green New Deal, the proposed Green New Deal, and Medicare for All, universal health care. In the wake of her meteoric rise to national fame, there seemed to be some conciliation between the party's leadership and at least the left edge of the party represented by Ocasio-Cortez. And you'll see any number of examples. You know, there was a magazine cover where the incoming freshman appeared with Pelosi. You know, they've been approvingly speaking of each other in the last several weeks. And so I think there has been an effort to reconcile those competing poles. At the end of the day, though, I think that reconciliation cannot hold because at the end of the day, these positions and worldviews are very opposed. The Democratic leadership is committed to corporations before communities, and the progressive wing of the party is not. We put people before profits, and that will lead to tension. That will lead to predictable challenges, particularly over issues like universal health care, like urgent solutions to the increasingly dire climate crisis. I think the war and peace issues in the face of militarism present those same tensions to no less an extent. And on each of these issues, I think that there will inevitably be moments of conflict, a potentially very sharp conflict of the sort that we saw this week. I think that the advantage in that conflict is very much to the progressives, precisely because the electorate has been increasingly emboldened and, I dare say, radicalized by the abuses and serial lies of our kleptocrat in chief and career Democrats who are willing to play a game that looks like business as usual, while the country, our civilization, and our planet are on fire, delegitimate themselves. And I think at the end of the day, as long as the Democratic leadership refuses to embrace the transformative policies needed to respond to the needs of the future, we have no choice but ultimately to challenge and eventually remove them. And that's exactly what I'm trying to do here in California.
Or be yourself removed by the power of money, which is the strength of the leadership.
You're absolutely right that the leadership's control over the party historically has been a function of its ability to raise money from its corporate benefactors and its corporate beneficiaries. At the end of the day, however, money can't win elections. Voters win elections and volunteers win elections. And while we are certainly outgunned in fundraising, and I'll admit at the outset, there's not any more than a snowball's chance in hell that I will match Nancy Pelosi's fundraising totals at the end of this race. But at the end of the day, I don't need to either. We only need to mount a campaign that is capable of reaching across the city. And that will take resources, but it won't take the kind of resources that she showers across the country to all of these corporate Democrats in different districts. Which is just to say, my job is to mount a campaign to reach across the country and beat the Pelosi machine in votes in 2020. You're absolutely right that they've got the money advantage. You're absolutely right that that's how they've held their seats for so long. I think the times are a-changing, and I think that the voters will have their say at the end of this day.
In terms of irreconcilability, certainly the positions on Israel leave very little room for maneuver for progressives. You can't say anything that sounds even indirectly critical of Israel without being called anti-Semitic.
Which is a real problem, because criticism of Israel and criticism of a particular foreign government is not anti-Semitic. It's not racist to say that Netanyahu is corrupt and Israel has been maintaining an untenable military occupation violating international human rights laws. That is, those are not anti-Semitic statements. Those are statements of fact. And ultimately, it does a disservice to Jewish people to equate those things with anti-Semitism, because it suggests, frankly, that that community doesn't deserve the thoughtful debate among competing perspectives that in democracies, we are committed to believing leads us to a better outcome. There's a further piece here, both within Congress and within the United States. Ilhan Omar's comments, to some extent, made the point and drew attention to the fact that members of Congress do not enjoy independence with respect to these issues, that many of them are effectively silenced by the carrot and the stick that AIPAC presents, the carrot and the money that it can offer and the stick in the opprobrium visible, for instance, this week in the Democratic leadership's attempts to censure Omar. Those commitments to robust freedom of speech for legislators attain constitutional significance, especially when we look at the states. Many states have proposed, and several have already adopted, measures that criminalize boycotts, particularly of Israel. These are First Amendment rights of Americans that we are sacrificing for the sake of supporting a proxy power across the world. The idea that we would not only silence legitimate debate and critique of an important foreign policy issue is bad enough, but for us to risk our most fundamental constitutional commitments over that same set of interests, I think reflects just how very deeply co-opted the corporate democratic leadership has become. And it's one reason why it becomes increasingly important for we the people to replace them with people who remember at the very least the requirements of the First Amendment to the U.S. Constitution.
That was human rights activist Shahid Buttar speaking from San Francisco.
Women in Africa are reshaping what it means to be a feminist. And Kozo Yenwana is a doctoral student and researcher for the African Sex Worker Alliance. Yenwana identifies as an African feminist scholar activist. She wrote a recent essay on sex work and feminism in Africa titled We Fit in the Society by Force.
I got interested in sex worker rights activism when I first started volunteering for SWET, which is the Sex Workers Education and Advocacy Task Force. It's an NGO based in South Africa that advocates for the rights of adult consenting sex workers. And it was during this time that I realized that the kind of stereotypes that are out there, predominantly in your mainstream media, about sex workers was not necessarily matching the sex workers that I was encountering when working at SWIT. And my main interest around being an African sex worker feminist came about during our engagement with your local feminists, other academic feminists, when we'd go and try engage them around giving us support and solidarity in advocating for rights, specifically the decriminalization of sex work. What we realized is that in those spaces, the other feminists we were encountering were not very receptive to us. They saw us as victims that needed to be rescued. So they weren't seeing us fellow feminists around the table trying to arrive at solutions collectively. And we found this very disempowering, which was quite unfortunate considering what feminist spaces are supposed to be about. So that's when we decided to take a step back as the feminist group at the time at SWET called Awake to just evaluate for ourselves then what does it mean to be a sex worker who also self-identifies as a feminist and who is based within the African continent. And that's how I got interested in the topic.
How prevalent, from your observations, is politicalness among sex workers? That is, a political identity and political kind of program and solidarity.
Well, because the sex workers that I worked with in both the studies that I referenced in the paper, Sisonke, which is the South African National Movement of Sex Workers, and ASWA, which is the African Sex Worker Alliance, because the members of Sisonke and ASWA are already activists, the identity of being a sex worker is quite political for them, because it's, first of all, trying to combat the moral stigma that's often associated with the term prostitute or prostitution, and trying to rather get people to understand the selling of sex as work. So in that sense, it's very political. It's part of the advocacy campaign for decriminalization, because we do want the selling of sex to be recognized as work.
And what is the official attitude towards decriminalization in South Africa?
Well, currently in South Africa, sex work, which in our law is called prostitution, is fully criminalized, which means the buyer, the client, the seller, the sex worker, and anyone living off the earnings of a sex worker, so your madams, pimps, are all considered criminals under our law. So for the last 20-odd years with Sisonke, have been pushing hard for the law to be reformed so that sex work is seen as any other form of work and sex workers are then able to access your labor rights, your health and safety, occupational health rights. So in that sense, we've tried to make some headway, but the South African Law Reform Commission released a report, I think it was 2 years back, and unfortunately, even with all our lobbying and our advocacy, the report recommends that Parliament retain criminalization and also recommends that sex workers go for rehab, which we're not quite sure what we're being rehabilitated for. Or it also recommends that we go for partial criminalization, which would see the client being criminalized but not the sex worker, which actually does not make much sense if you ask me, because it's like asking a vegetable street vendor to sell their fruits and veggies, but then turning around and saying, I'll arrest anyone who tries to buy from you. So we're not quite sure how sex workers are then expected to make a living under that legal model. So at this point, what government has embarked on is public discussions, which Switch and Sisonke are actively engaging in, to try and get a sense from your general public whether they feel that decriminalization of sex work is what is needed. And quite interestingly enough, within the general South African population, the impression I get is that people morally might not support the selling of sex, but they actually do understand that it's a livelihood choice, and they do generally allow sex workers to continue doing the business as is. But we do have cases whereby your community policing forum might start harassing sex workers, or perhaps brothel managers might also take advantage of sex workers. But we feel as if the public is ready to engage on this issue and make an informed decision, which we believe government should take into serious consideration.
And part of that discussion, of course, deals with the threat of AIDS.
Yes. And actually, much of our argument for decriminalization has come from the health perspective. Because if you really are serious about combating STIs such as HIV/AIDS, which is quite prevalent in our South African population, then you need to be working with sex workers, because they are considered one of the key populations. And working with sex workers, not in the sense of seeing sex workers solely as vectors of disease, but rather agents of change. Because what we find is that the Department of Health, for instance, would provide us with condoms to distribute during our outreaches. But then the South African police services would then turn around and confiscate those condoms and actually use them as evidence against sex workers. So we find that government is quite confused in terms of how to deal with HIV/AIDS within the sex work industry. And one of the things we're saying is that, well, if you decriminalize sex work, then sex workers will be free to actually use and carry condoms, which is an important tool in our trade. If you think of a surgeon doesn't go and operate without gloves. In the same sense, a sex worker shouldn't have to engage in sex work without their condom, and that should be their right. So much of our argument has actually stemmed from the fact that including sex workers within the HIV/AIDS strategy to combat HIV/AIDS would be quite helpful.
You write that you wanted to explore what it meant to be African, a sex worker, and a feminist. What did you learn?
Well, one of the things that, the main thing that I actually took out from the study is that even though these three identities may, at face value, be seen as incongruous, in certain embodiments, they actually inform each other. So, for instance, in terms of being an African and being a sex worker, some of the participants expressed how in their communities, there's a sense that being a sex worker is un-African. But some of them were like, well, we don't understand this. And I'm thinking specifically to one of the participants called Frida, who I'll quote in the paper. She recalls a time when she was quite young, growing up in the Eastern Cape. And she remembers having to go for virginity testing. And she says that if you were found that you were no longer a virgin, then your mother, along with other older women in your community, would then have to strip you naked and walk you through the village to the boy's home, the boy who would have taken your virginity, and demand damages. That's what it's called, damages, in the form of cows. And she was like, well, how is that different to sex work? I was like, okay, can you expand on this a bit? Well, she was like, well, for her, it feels as if within her closer culture, at least, woman's sex had some kind of monetary value. And she doesn't understand then why is it an issue when she wants to cash in on her own sex. But when it's her mother and the woman in the village, it's considered okay and actually sanctioned culturally. And she even made an example of lobola, which is bride wealth. So it's a quite common cultural practice here in South Africa with most of African cultures. And with lobola, the soon-to-be groom is expected to pay a certain number of cows. Nowadays, we don't usually use physical cows, but money, to the soon-to-be bride's family. And then she was like, well, what is that all about? There's some kind of exchange of monetary value for the bride to be sex, confirming that she will only have sex with this man for the rest of her life. But when she wants to have sex on her conditions and decide how much for what sexual services, then it's an issue, but it's okay when it's her uncle demanding lobola. So it was quite interesting for me how the participants were actually able to draw from their own cultural practices to actually affirm and show that actually selling sex is not that un-African as we tend to imagine it. And then in terms of being a sex worker and a feminist, as I mentioned before, because the participants came from sex worker rights groups and movements, they were already quite conscientized, and many of them were activists, self-identified as activists. And for them, being a sex worker kind of actually affirmed their feminism, specifically when they related it to their sex worker rights activism. They felt as if within their sex worker rights activism, because they're fighting for their bodily integrity, the right to be able to be economically self-sustaining and being able to actually tell a client, this is what I'm willing to do and this is what I'm not willing to do and this is my price. They felt as if those were the kind of qualities that feminism, I'll use a plural because they're many strands, feminism tends to promote. And they felt as if being a sex worker actually helped them in their self-identification as feminists. So that was quite interesting for me to pick up. And just to close off the triangle, what was also quite interesting is how the participants were able to link back how self-identifying as a feminist helped improve the way in which they did their sex work. So one of the participants that I had worked with in the initial study, which was the wake group at SWEC, initially when we started the sex worker feminist group, she was like, well, you know, I've heard of this feminist thing, and I'm not really sure about it. But when we started engaging in some of the literature by your Amina Mamas, Silver Tamale, and also discussing the fact that Maya Angelou at some point worked as a sex worker or in a brothel, their minds actually started opening up. And they were like, actually, now that I can confidently claim to be a feminist, when I'm on the streets and a client asks me to have unprotected sex, for example, I'm actually able to tell them, no, that's not how I roll. I always use a condom. And if that's not for you, then you can just take your money and cough. And that's a direct quote, by the way. So it was quite interesting to see how just taking the time and space away from your mainstream feminist dialogue and taking the time to reevaluate for ourselves what it means to be an African, what it means to be a sex worker, and what it means to be a feminist, actually resulted in us being able to come around full circle and actually realize how that self-identification of being a feminist actually also helped inform and strengthen our sex worker rights politics.
South Africa may be an unfinished revolution, but it does have a revolutionary tradition. How has that put its mark on the politics of sex workers?
Well, for one, we've got very good relations with civil society organizations, from your women's group to your LGBTQI+ group. So what we tend to do is to support each other in our social justice agendas. And what that has done really is to help strengthen each other's advocacy efforts, but also help us in terms of pushing our agendas forward. So for example, there is a coalition of groups of or organizations or individuals who are in support of decriminalization of sex work. And the coalition is called Asijiki, which means we're not turning. And this coalition is made up of, I think at the last count, it was nearly 70 groups, organizations, and individuals. And that's because of that revolutionary spirit that I feel as if South Africa still carries with it, where we're able to bring these diverse groups of organizations who are dealing with their own core social justice agendas, but were able to say, okay, for this cause, we're willing to be part of this coalition. So definitely it's allowed us to form those networks, to harness that solidarity and help us push the decriminalization agenda a bit further.
Earlier in this talk, you spoke of the misunderstandings that you encountered with feminists who were not sex workers and their attitude towards the sex workers.
The fact that sex workers' lives, specifically African sex workers, the people that I've worked with mostly in my scholar activism, African sex workers' lives are quite complex in the sense that we aren't able to neatly fit into the quote-unquote happy hooker trope, because we do engage in sex work primarily for socioeconomic reasons. But with that said, we don't also want to be seen as denying the human rights violations that we experience in the industry. So we also don't want to be seen as victims, but rather we would have our fellow feminists engage with us in terms of the kind of challenges that we're facing, and actually help us deal with them, specifically in pushing for decriminalization, because much of the human rights violations that we are facing right now are stemming from criminalization. The fact that police are able to do whatever brothel managers and pimps are able to exploit. But what we're trying to say is that we don't want to be seen solely as victims, and we don't necessarily want to be considered extreme pro-sex work activists, because our lived realities tend to occupy the space in between the pro and the anti-sex work spectrum. So we need whatever interventions that we come up with as feminist collective to speak to that blurriness in between, because that's what our lived realities are about, that blurriness and having to navigate that space in between.
That was Nkosi Yenwana speaking from South Africa.
Last month, hundreds of inmates froze for days in their cells when power went out at the infamous Metropolitan Detention Center, or MDC, in Brooklyn, New York. Black Agenda Radio producer Kyle Frazier spoke with a federal prisoner who's organizing behind the bars with IWOC, the Incarcerated Workers Organizing Committee, and who spent time at MDC and wrote an essay on the power failure. He calls himself John Brown, 912.
Earlier this month, the city of New York and the world watched detainees at MDC Brooklyn freeze in their cells during the most recent polar vortex. People were in awe that this high-tech, modern-day dungeon, with both the Statue of Liberty and Wall Street in view as testaments to hypocrisy, would be so crass, so brutal, so inhumane. No heat, no food or water, as detainees were locked in their cells as a result of a power outage stemming from a fire. Crowds of people gathered outside witnessing people, not inmates, people, banging on windows, shouting and crying in horror, fearing for their lives, locked away and forgotten in the 9-story Sunset Park detention facility. There were reports from the inside of pigs shaken down, that is to say, ransacking cells, looking for contraband cell phones, the only means of communication by which prisoners locked in their cells could communicate their predicament to outside friends, families, and supporters. Shouting and banging on cell doors was met with fire hoses. Terrified family members of those inside with no recourse but to rush the building and plead with the officers were pepper sprayed. As someone who did almost 4 years there, who left behind many loved ones over there, it made my blood boil. And yet I was not surprised at all. Warden Quay, who didn't even have the minimal amount of human compassion to provide extra blankets, it's the same Warden Quay who shut down the mental health unit in February 2016, transferring vulnerable people, I say again, people, not inmates, afflicted with schizophrenia, autism, PTSD, and cerebral palsy to the overcrowded general population. Yes, I remember in the wintertime they wouldn't turn the heat on even when the electricity was working. I remember how we'd complain and they'd send a cop in to wave some fake thermometer around that always stayed at 60 to 70 degrees. Yup, vermin and scabies infested MDC. I remember you. I remember the beat up squad. I remember the retaliation against anyone who raised their voice in dissent, including myself who, upon sending out an email about so-called gang members on the Bronx 120 indictment being arbitrarily rounded up and sent to the SHU, had my cell ransacked by the facility's Red Squad. Better not get sick in MDC, because medical might kill you. Everyone knows that. Yup, MDC Brooklyn, goddamn. And this was happening well before de Blasio and other politicians expressed their fall outrage. Well before our oppression was trending on social media. Disclaimer, by saying that, I do not intend to belittle the support of ordinary people who, from no fault of their own, had just found out about MDC through recent events. But if you ask the average incarcerated person, they'll say, yeah, you know, jail is jail. And that's what it is. This is happening all over the system in places that you've never heard of before nor dreamed of going to. MDC Brooklyn is just in your face about it. Smack dab in the middle of the liberal metropolis of downtown Brooklyn. Just a few blocks away from the Barclays Center. I was able to see it for myself. The support is appreciated and much needed, but make sure you ask yourself the question, and this is most sincerely directed towards specifically the white liberals who were in awe of what they saw in their progressive city. Does it bother you because we're innocent until proven guilty, or does it bother you simply because we're human? One thing's for sure, two things for certain. You don't reform oppression, you abolish it. So, which side are you on? Hashtag no new jails. Hashtag shut them down. Sincerely, John Brown, 912.
No doubt. Much appreciated. And so some of the highlights that I noticed as far as the shutdowns, and not just this one, but historically these shutdowns at MDC and all over, is this question of the so-called contraband phones, right? And inside to outside communication. Now, we know that on these lockdowns, they're shutting access to the usual phones and usual communication. So could you just speak on that question of silencing y'all's voices on the inside, especially under emergency circumstances?
Firstly, as an incarcerated person, whether no matter where you are, whether you're in a detention center or a long-term facility, your communications with the outside world is under total surveillance. Like, the email system is basically a tool of surveillance because they read all your emails. The letters are read back and forth. These phone calls are monitored. So there's nothing that you could get to the outside world that is not being surveilled and monitored. So it's nearly impossible to report on struggles going on within or conditions going on within without, you know, getting some sort of retaliation back, or at least them knowing your every footstep, knowing what you're doing. You know, and they know this. So that's one of the reasons why they crack down on almost any other alternative form of communication. You know, it's a big shot too. Like, people get locked up to stuff like that, they could get a new sentence. You know, they could get extra time added to their sentence. They could be sent to long-term solitary confinement. If you're in a low facility prison and you get caught with one, you could go to a penitentiary, you know? So that's the seriousness of, you know, the situation. Brothers who got caught in MDC, if they were caught, they could have gotten more time, and that would have been sent to their judge. And the shot doesn't read, oh, you're trying to communicate the situation that's going on. The shot reads, you got a contraband cell phone, and they're going to try to, you know, they were painted as like, oh, well, you were trying to do illegal activity. So it adds to that, you know, especially if you're a detainee awaiting sentencing, you know.
And we know that recently the federal defenders had filed a lawsuit against MDC due to this occurrence, claiming that their clients were disallowed from contacting them. And that was the basis for their lawsuit. But now we see that apparently a federal judge has halted that lawsuit. Do you have any comments on that, or the larger question of legal action against MDC or those who are overseeing MDC from your experience?
Well, I mean, my experience in MDC, even legal phone calls are monitored. Like, don't get it twisted. Like, when I used to call or email my lawyer, like, my lawyer wouldn't even want to email or have me call him on the phone, because they do monitor those phone calls as well. You know, and you have to, you even have to put in a special request and go through a million yards of bureaucratic red tape to get an unmonitored phone call. So the majority of prisoners over there do not even get privileged communication with their lawyers. You know, and when it comes to visits, you know, usually the lawyers are subject to the same restrictions as any other regular visitor. And so you might be in a room with him, you know, without any guard present, but at the same time, he can't give you any legal material or anything like that. He or she has to go all the way to MDC, you know, to communicate anything with you, you know. So as far as, like, legal communications go, like MDC, again, MDC has been, actually, not just MDC, all over the federal system, has been meddling with legal communication, you know, with your lawyer. So, I hope that lawsuit ends up going through, you know, but we also have to understand that even through the mechanisms that are in process right now, they legally intercept privileged communication on a regular.
And continuing in the vein of the duplicity of not only MDC, but all of these federal and otherwise facilities. But given that we're talking about MDC in particular, the pretense in this instance was allegedly that there was a power outage, and that's why they couldn't provide the necessary heat and other necessities at that moment. Could you speak a bit about the difference between the claims of, let's say, the warden at MDC or other officials inside versus the actual conditions experienced by those who are suffering under those?
Well, like I said, you know, power outage or not, the heat was almost never on at MDC, Brook, you know, and as far as, like, power outages go, you know, every facility generally has a generator, and I mean, I've been in situations where, I've been in a situation at MDC where there was a power outage like that, and the generator also went out. This was during a heat wave, not a polar vortex, you know, and this was under a different warden, you know, and they, you know, they had to hand out, you know, water bottles and stuff like that, and guys were bathing themselves in rain puddles because the plumbing wasn't working. But the fact of the matter is, power outage or not, he had to get public pressure to get out blankets. That just shows, like, the basic lack of human compassion, you know?
And that's it for this edition of Black Agenda Radio. Be sure to visit us at blackagendareport.com, where you will find a new and provocative issue each Wednesday. That's www.blackagendareport.com. It's the place for news, commentary, and analysis from the Black left. I'm Nellie Bailey, along with my co-host, Glen Ford. Our thanks to the good people at the Progressive Radio Network.